The next item of business is consideration of business motion 15226 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button, and I call on the Minister to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 15226 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Stephen Kerr.
Hopefully not a grumpy old man, but thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of an increased risk to public safety resulting from industrial action by the Scottish Police Federation.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government greatly values the dedication shown by police officers, and in recognition of this, we have made a very fair offer of 4.57%. This is above inflation, the same as awarded to police officers in England and Wales, and it is the maximum affordable offer given the severe pressures on public finances. Officers in Scotland have consistently been the best paid in the UK, and our offer would ensure that remained the case. I am disappointed that the Scottish Police Federation has asked its members to withdraw goodwill while the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland continues to progress the claim through its conciliation and arbitration processes. In the meantime, I have been assured by the Chief Constable and the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority that plans are in place to manage the impact of this action.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, but she'll forgive me, I hope, if I am not reassured by the one sentence at the end of her answer that was in response to my specific question. Because this is a monumental mess of the SNP's own making. Morale in Police Scotland is at rock bottom, goodwill is gone. Starved of resources by the SNP government, the thin blue line is stretched to breaking point. And David Kennedy's letter of the 30th of October is a cry of despair on behalf of his members. The action now taken by the SPF will see a massive increase in overtime payments and huge gaps in cover. Public safety must always be the primary responsibility of any government. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that this SNP government is failing in this duty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, if I can say with respect to Mr Kerr that Scotland remains a safer place today under this government than any of our predecessors. And just for clarity for the record, we have made a very fair offer of 4.75%. And I would like to point to the facts that for every year since 2016, this government has increased investment in our policing, and that has contributed to a police force that we are all proud of.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, again, not much of a reassurance about the issue of public safety, given the gaps that there will now be in that very thin blue line. We have the lowest number of frontline police officers since 2007. And just look at yesterday's report from HMICS on the impact of reduction in overall officer numbers. This matters. Police officers are leaving the service at the first opportunity. Stress-related absences are at an all-time high, and shift safety levels are routinely ignored. And how embarrassing is it that this industrial action by Scotland's police officers is happening when Scotland is hosting Interpol in Glasgow? What will the Cabinet Secretary now do to fix this mess of the SNP's own making?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important to stress to Mr Kerr and indeed Parliament that negotiations are still continuing. Nonetheless, I did seek very specific reassurances from both the Chief Constable and the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority about how the withdrawal of goodwill, what impact that would have and how that would be managed. And thanks to this government, investment in policing in this very financial year has increased by £92 million. That is an increase of in excess of 5% at a time when the consequences of Tory austerity have been very real. And I'm very pleased to inform Parliament that police numbers are once again rising, and that, of course, is thanks to the record level of investment from this government.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I note the Cabinet Secretary's confirmation that the pay claims continue to be progressed through the PNB for Scotland. I wonder if she could further explain the two separate processes for police pay and if any pay offer will be backdated.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, police officer pay is negotiated through the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland, involving the Scottish Police Authority, Police Scotland and the Scottish Government. Police staff pay negotiations take place through the Joint Negotiating Consultative Committee with the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland negotiating with the trade unions. These formal structures are important. They provide police officers and staff in Scotland with a collective pay bargaining process. And as I've intimated, that process remains ongoing. And of course, once agreement is reached, that is backdated.
Thank you. Question number two, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I remind members that I'm the convener of the RMT Parliamentary Group. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of any potential implications for accessibility, equality and safety for passengers and the public, whether it will permit the reduction in opening hours of ticket offices by ScotRail.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
No offices will be closed and there will not be any job losses. ScotRail ticket offices opening hours have remained unchanged for over 30 years, but ticket office sales have reduced markedly from 78% to 14% over that period. Scottish Rail Holdings and ScotRail have rightly reviewed this to ensure that they deliver services that meet passenger expectations. The Scottish Government must ensure ScotRail is deploying its resources in the best interests of passengers, and I have considered ScotRail's proposals carefully and am content with these proposals. ScotRail's proposals would see an increase in the hours that ticket offices are open in 12 stations, while there would be a reduction of opening times of less than 60 minutes at 21 stations and a reduction of more than 60 minutes at 33 stations. Presiding Officer, making these proposed adjustments to ticket office opening hours will enable the redeployment of some ScotRail staff to provide more and better assistance for passengers, especially disabled passengers. It will also mean that staff are more visible, and this will help to deter antisocial behaviour and reduce fare evasion.
Richard Leonard.
The Cabinet Secretary protests that there are no ticket office closures, but ticket offices at 54 stations across Scotland will be closed at parts of the day they are currently open. Although we don't even know where the axe will fall, because the list in the ScotRail press release last week, they now admit, is wrong. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that ScotRail had screwed up, not least in applying now obsolete criteria based on ticket sales alone, when the current procedure for reviewing ticket offices, which is now in force, requires decisions to be based on assistance, safety, security and access? So will she today direct ScotRail to apply the up-to-date tests rather than the defunct ones? And will the Cabinet Secretary publish the equality impact assessment of these proposed cuts to booking office opening hours?
Cabinet Secretary.
Particular equality impact assessments have been conducted. They are reflected in the proposals. I hear what the member has said in terms of the criteria, but I think it's important to look at the benefits of safety and particularly antisocial behaviour affecting passengers. The visibility of ScotRail staff can help address that. Looking at trying to provide more dedicated passenger assistance, including for disabled passengers, is very, very important as part of that service. The advice from Transport Focus, who represent passengers, has been included. But in terms of the proposals, they will go to consultation with unions and affected employees, and that will take a period of 12 weeks.
Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, here are the facts. Over 98% of responses to this consultation oppose these cuts. The TSSA has described ScotRail as disingenuous, putting women and vulnerable passengers at risk. The RMT, led by its members on the front line, say this is closure by stealth. Does the Cabinet Secretary for Transport not begin to understand that it is a fraud on the travelling public to describe these cuts as frontline customer service improvements? Doesn't she understand how angry people are after cuts to railway maintenance, hikes in fares and now station ticket office hours to be slashed? The Scottish Government is the sole shareholder of ScotRail. Will the Cabinet Secretary use that shareholder power to intervene?
Cabinet Secretary.
A number of factual inaccuracies in what Richard Leonard said, and he might want to reflect on that, particularly in relation to some of the maintenance budgets issues, which I've personally addressed in a number of letters to a number of MSPs in the past. The consultation has just started, so Mr Leonard, I think, can factually be incorrect in responding to a previous consultation. In terms of that 12-week period, it will take us until at least March 2025. I do think if we reflect that ticket offices are not being used as they were for ticket office sales, it's important that we protect staff. It's important we protect staff's jobs. But there will be an opportunity in the consultation that has just started to enable that discussion and dialogue, both with the employees and with the unions, to ensure what we know that passengers want and need is more visibility of ScotRail staff that help them feel more safe and secure. And I constantly get asked about antisocial behaviour on our railways, and this change from having people within ticket offices to be more visible in our stations and on our trains, I think will be welcomed, particularly by the travelling public.
Thank you. I call Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, ScotRail has stated that where ticket offices see reduced hours, staff will carry out, as you say, other customer support and roles, including increasing staff visibility. Can you say any more about what assessment has been made about how this can help to increase safety within stations in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
So ScotRail's experience is that targeting antisocial behaviour through proactively planning more visible staff presence at the right locations makes our rail network safer and provides assurance to passengers. ScotRail's proposed changes in staff deployment will make over 60 more staff available actively to support passengers in this way, and it's estimated that this increased presence would deliver an additional 11.5 million opportunities per year for interactions between staff and passengers, and it's those interactions that help provide that reassurance to passengers and also helps tackle antisocial behaviour.
Thank you. Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the proposals from ScotRail for Lockerbie Station, they make the same mistake they did last time in getting the current opening times of the station wrong, which I highlighted to them at the time and to your predecessor in this chamber. They're also proposing new opening times that make it impossible for staff to sell tickets in time for two of the busiest trains of the day for the sake of 10 minutes. The proposed new times would also mean staff not being there to dispatch some of the Avanti services from the station, which I presume is a contractual arrangement. So when the Cabinet Secretary says she's content with these proposals, is she really content that they're misleading the public over the current opening times, and is she content that they haven't clearly thought through these proposals for Lockerbie Station?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much appreciate the comments the member has made. He obviously knows the detail in relation to Lockerbie Station. ScotRail will, I am sure, be paying attention to this question, and indeed I will expect them to respond to me directly and also to the member to address the points that he's made.
Mark Cruskell.
The decision to bring back peak fares has brought back complex, costly and confusing ticketing on ScotRail services. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that reducing ticket office opening hours not only removes passengers' access to expert ticketing advice to get the cheapest tickets, but it also significantly disadvantages disabled passengers who require assistance when travelling on our rail network? What kind of consultation can the Cabinet Secretary continue with disability rights groups to ensure that they're not disadvantaged by these changes?
Secretary.
Well, it's important to reflect that the access to information points are being rolled out and expanded, particularly that is a requirement from ourselves to ensure that the issues that have been raised previously are addressed. I think the point about making sure there are more staff available to help people with disabilities on and off our trains is important. I think the fact that in Scotland that only 1 hour notice is required compared to 2 hours in the rest of the UK is a reflection of how importantly we take those issues. But in terms of that ticketing information, that is why the access points are being expanded, precisely to ensure that. But the proposals have to reflect the changes in people's behaviour, passengers' behaviours, as to when they are choosing to travel, when they are choosing to buy their tickets, and also how they are proposing to purchase that ticket. And increasingly, as we all know, this is being done digitally.
Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she can guarantee that these changes, if they go ahead, will increase the staff presence and visibility at stations? Because when previously when officers have been reduced, this hasn't been the case. And I am concerned that the Cabinet Secretary says she is content at this point in time with these proposals when so many concerns are being raised across the Chamber.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, these proposals have just been announced. It's going into a period of consultation with the affected staff, and I think the individual points and indeed the reflections of members here can be relayed at that point. In terms of the issues around reflecting concerns and that feedback, that's also why the Transport Focus feedback on the previous consultation has been important, and that accessibility to information is critical. Circumstances have changed. I think it would be very odd for any organisation not to change its processes, particularly reflecting the change in passenger behaviour, activity, times, in order to reflect the realities of where we are. I think her point is, in terms of the redeployment, that's exactly what that has to be, is redeployment for visibility and accessibility, which can't necessarily happen if somebody has to stay in a ticket office for those extended hours.